Subway's coming over.
Nope. No deal. You want to get eaten by rats?
No, I think I'll skip getting eaten by rats. It's not high on my list of things to do today. A weave top? That's better, isn't it? I also, at the end of last episode, sold a bunch of clothes. Actually, yeah, find it easier to just do this. Okay, it's a old windbreaker. Somehow better than a ballistic vest. The darker side of Kitsch. Alright, so now we're all illin, yeah. Nothing there. Oh, look at that. We picked up a bunch of stuff since I sold all that stuff. Stylish double weave shirt and vest. 133. Does it go in order of armor? Seems like, maybe. Okay. Doesn't pair well with red wine at corporate banquets. I don't think it changed. Yeah, it didn't change again. I should have a little bow tie, and I don't. I'm not complaining, I don't really want a bow tie. Oh, it's a wreath and put a mod on it. Oh, I have the armadillo mod. Okay. This is nothing good. Force open. I can actually force that open. I'm amazed. Geisha flexi weave cargo pants. Oh, there's something in there too. That's locked. Locked. Protein Farms, a report. I'll read that later. Sniper rifle ammo. I don't think there's anybody else here. No future. Something very important there. Oh, geez. Dead person, euro dollars. Yeah, they were operating as a unlicensed ripper doc. Hooray for rifle and sniper rifle ammo. I'll pick that up in a second. Heal on kill. Crafting spec slow rotor. Instantly restores 3% health after defeating an enemy. butcher's cleaver. What's an actual cleaver? Sharp and lethal. Be careful not to cut yourself. And orders for patience. Oh, I didn't mean to hit the... Damn. Orders placed. Arriving this week. Kiroshi nose filters. Biodyne WR098 Infinity. Premium version. Enhanced strength thighs. Set of Arasaka subdermal pockets for the top smugglers. 12 2-gen augmented muscle weaves from Militech. And 3 EX plus kidneys from Biotechnica. That's ridiculous. Oh, did we solve that then? Jeez. That's where I just was. Thought that was Panama for a second. Where it came out? Yeah. I guess we've seen it all. Yeah. I'll be to the Merc needed next. Where's those other... apartment? It says my apartment's over there. Maybe a second apartment with the Aldecaldos, maybe? Yeah, it's gotta be the hotel. Okay. So wait, where am I headed? I'm all the way over here. Okay. Should we do a little light reading first? Why not? Okay, no articles then. Nomads for the thick-skinned. Okay, the matter is simple. Whatever you read or hear about the nomads in the city media doesn't hold an ounce of water. The biggest lie bandied around is that being a nomad is a job. It's not. Nomadism is a lifestyle. See, if you want to know something about nomads, all you have to do is ask one yourself. Luckily, I already know the questions because I've been asked them 1,000 times. So let's get started, shall we? 1. Why did the nomads organize themselves? Well, why not unite millions of people roaming around the country? Besides, if you know what you're looking for, you'll instantly know which clan a nomad belongs to. Which brings us to our next point. Nomads are divided into nations. Nations are divided into clans. Clans are broken down into families. You'll recognize them by their colors, their jackets, and the decals on their cars and bikes. By the way, nomads take their affiliation seriously, so unless you want a broken jaw, I'd advise you do the same. 2, you'll be eating dirt or worse if you get nomads and Raffins mixed up. Remember, Raffin, Shiv are not nomads. They're pariahs, outcasts, criminals who are either exiled from their clan for doing something truly effed up, let me just say effed up, or just ordinary city criminals on the run. Raffins form packs not because it's convenient, because they don't have a choice. Nobody in their right mind would work with them. unless they somehow fit in their your plans. Mostly they rob and pillage. Don't ask me where the name Raffin Shiv comes from. All I know is that apparently it means something really dirty. Well, a shiv is a blade. Oh, what a raffin is. Nomads take on all kinds of jobs. Everybody has to eat, right? What kinds of jobs they take depends on the clan or family's particular strategy. Some pick crops in agrocorp fields. Others deal with corp shipments or protect their convoys. If you want to smuggle something across the border, you go to the nomads. If you need to vanish off your pissed off creditors or shareholders' radar, the nomads will take you so far into the boonies you'll be crapping next to scorpions. You pay, they do the job, you shake hands, and everyone goes their separate ways. Get it now? If you want more specifics, just grow a pair and talk to a real nomad. Good luck. People of Night City... Smuggling. If you want to transport goods, you'll need contacts. Without contacts, forget about doing business. Who will you need to pay off? Custom officers, guards, the people at the gas stations. Don't forget the motels. You take care of that, you can show up and vanish as you please. Keep them happy and they'll know when to turn a blind eye. It's also a good idea to strike a rapport with the fellows from orbital air. That is, if you're planning to ship something into orbit. Remember those boxes full of seedlings last year? That could only have happened because my boys at OA Customs looked the other way for 15 seconds. Make sure you're well equipped. Don't use standard signal jammers. Customs agents aren't stupid. They'll know you're hiding something at the border, besides which there are no models they can't disable. Use upgraded jammers that work hyper-locally in the exact place you're hiding the goods. Secure packages with ice, ideally bought from us. You can trust family. Use your imagination. Do you know how I managed to transport a few dozen pounds of drugs to SoCal? I paid the right people not to ask any questions and hitched a ride with an old foods convoy. Nobody realized that several containers of food were packed full with drugs. Plan your routes carefully. You'll have up-to-date border patrol routes and areas scanned in real time by corporate satellites, and you have good old American roads. Use back roads and routes that corporal convoys would rather avoid. You can also dance around those old minefields since the corps don't patrol there anymore, although apparently by now they know we passed through there and it's only a matter of time. Use the tunnels as a last resort. These days, it's usually a one-way trip. You go through one, and the second you're out, the satellites have a lock on you. So in case you do, step on it. And most of all, brothers and sisters, don't get caught. Excerpts from A History of the Nomads by B.B. Pyers. The First Nomad Code. 1. Protect and respect your clan, especially your family. 2. You're worth as much as your word. 3. Share with others in your clan. 4. Respect the privacy and well-being of your clan. 5. Never put your clan in danger. 6. Always take honest pay for honest work. The New Nomad Code. 1. Protect your family and clan in that order. 2. Do not steal from anyone in your clan. 3. Do not keep from yourself that which may help another in your clan. It's hard to imagine a group less inclined to wandering than farmers, but in fact they were the people who donned the Age of Nomads. Natural catastrophes, crops ravaged by bioplagues, armed conflicts, and martial law allowing corporations to speculate and privatize land. All this forced them into a life on the road. The first clans recognized as nomadic were the Aldecados and the Jodes, followed shortly after by Snake Nation, Thelas Nation, Fulk Nation, Blood Nation, and Metacorp, a total of 7 nations. The nomad nations are divided into tribes, which are subdivided even further into clans and families. A family typically numbers between 10 and 100 people, while the biggest nations can reach up to 1 million. At first, nomad activity was seen as anarchistic and subversive, mostly, as you can imagine, by corporations who quickly realized they wouldn't be able to control them. The biggest irony in all this is that it's thanks to the nomads in our cities that our cities were rebuilt after the wars and catastrophes that marked the first half of the 21st century. After all, families come together to build, not to destroy. Oh, I missed this archive conversation. Dylan Connell and Mandy Patrick. Dylan says, gzz, gzz, do you copy? Do you copy? What's the password? I did read this. I read that. Oh, never mind. The Odyssey. Is this really from the Odyssey by Homer? Huh, I guess so. Say what thy birth and what the name you bore, imposed by parents in a natal hour. For from the natal hour distinctive names, one common knight the great and lowly claims. Say from what city, from what regions tossed, and what inhabitants those regions boast. Okay, that's tossed, not toast. So what thou insist that so... Guys, a little thick here. So shalt thou instant reach the realm assigned in wondrous ships, self-moved, instinct with mind. No helm secures their course, no pilot guides. Like man intelligence, they plow the tides, conscious of every coast and every bay that lies beneath the sun's all-seeing ray. Though clouds and darkness veil the encumbered sky, fearless through darkness and through clouds they fly. Though tempests rage, though rolls the swelling main, the seas may roll, the tempests rage in vain. Even the stern god that o'er the waves presides, safe as they pass and safe repass the tides. With fury burns, while careless they convey, promiscuous every guest to every bay. These ears have heard my royal sire disclose a dreadful story big with future woes. How Neptune raged, and how by his command, firm-rooted in a surge, a ship should stand. A monument of wrath, how mound on mound, should bury these proud towers beneath the ground. But this the gods may frustrate or fulfill, as suits the purpose of the eternal will. But say through what waste regions hast thou strayed, what customs noted and what coasts surveyed. Possessed by wild barbarians, fierce in arms, or men whose bosom tendered pity warms? Say why the fate of Troy awaked thy cares, why heave thy bosom, and why flowed by thy tears, Homer. Alright, this will be the last one, I guess. The fall of the backers, I guess. The indirect cause of the family's weakening in leadership was, paradoxically, not enough internal opposition within the group. Decisions made by Salida Backer, the charismatic and surprisingly long-lived leader, were made without so much as a grumble, and her orders were carried out immediately. Salida led the Bakers with an iron fist. She was a domineering figure, perhaps overwhelmingly so, but you couldn't call her a tyrant. Loved and respected by all, toward the end of her life she seemed to regret that nobody in the family tried to take the power or at least challenge her authority. After her death, the family entered a transition period. Salida's position was occupied successfully by Dilu Backer, Lorna Ruiz, and Chari Dalin. None of them led the family for more than 2 years. Dilu died during a skirmish with Raff and Schiff. Lorna resigned, and Chari simply collected her things and disappeared from the camp one day. Well, it's another way of resigning. It seems that the family depended so long on Salida that, when she was gone, nobody could make any firm unilateral decisions. The family's subsequent leaders ruled without any conviction, in the words of Trin Backer, who, like many other young members, left the Backer family after it decided to merge with Snake Nation. Trin. When I looked at Dilu or Chari, I had the impression they had an invisible sign over their heads that said, "What would Salida do?" Lorna was all right, but she drank too much. To be honest, I don't blame her. I think Grandma's heart would break if she saw how quickly her successors went through the family supplies and tore up contracts and agreements with other clans. And the idea to join Snake Nation? We might as well have asked Raff and Schiff to line us up on the dirt and execute us. What's the difference? That was the true end of the family. That's why I, Ossian, Lil Elam, Afshin, Persia, and others decided to leave. SW. Do you still keep in touch? Trin. No. Yeah, we have... Should I just finish it? Maybe I should just finish it. The Coptic Bible. The Book of Enoch. And the angels, the children of the heaven, saw and lusted after them, and said to one another, "Come, let us choose us wives among the children of men, and beget us children." And all the others with them took unto themselves wives, and each chose for himself one. And they began to go in unto them, and to defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms and enchantments, and the cutting of roots, and made them acquainted with plants. All right. It sounds cool at the end there. And they became pregnant and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells, who consumed all the acquisitions of men, and when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind. And they began to sin against birds and beasts and reptiles and fish, and to devour one another's flesh and drink the blood. Then the earth laid accusation against the lawless ones. God. What giants? Who's that referring to? Mutant by moonlight. It was a night like every other. An oppressive black smog choked the city, pouring into the wicked hearts and lungs that breathed there. Acid rain drummed against thousands of window panes, the cityscape like a surreal tessellation of piano keys. 30 years come and went, nothing changed. I stood at the window, smoking cigarette after cigarette, my thoughts distracted by the memory of a woman I hadn't seen since the war's end. And then I heard a knock on the door, just like her, just like 30 years ago. "Come in," the hoarse words strained from my throat as I mechanically lifted my hand to the wall panel. The metal door slid open noiselessly, revealing a slender figure draped snugly by an inky black neo-mill dress. She stepped inside, her gold-plated hips glinting as they swayed. Her lips were a deep ebony, but her eyes, her predatorial yellow eyes, pierced mine and scanned me from head to toe. For a moment, it felt like they were prying my very soul from my body. Then I twisted my lips into an ugly smirk. I remembered my soul was already long gone. I left it in the war, along with the flowers I placed on my mother-in-law's grave. "Someone's out to zero me," she broke the silence with attention-demanding bluntness. The smooth allure of her voice clouded my mind. I never noticed her third hand, a mistake that would spell my doom. "Impossible," I started with the beginnings of a roguish grin. "Who would ever want to kill a woman with hips and lips like yours? And a corpo, no less." She narrowed her impenetrable yellow eyes for a moment. In a whir and a blur, she now pointed a machine gun at me with rock-steady aim. "You don't understand," she said quietly, her barrel fixed at a point between my eyes. "It's you. Don't you remember anything, dear brother?" Memories flashed. My nightmare of the war. Eusobio's blood, frayed wires, the tattered remains of a plush tapir received from Margaret just 2 days before she died, and her father's last words, words about my twin sister, a mutant, abandoned at birth, the promise that I'd find her. Too late, she found me. She was abandoned at birth, so... how would he remember her? He was looking for her, right? Not to kill her. I mean, who the hell knows? Kibble and Scop. Kibble stared glumly at his glass of a seaweed-colored drink. We got one more, right? Yeah, just one more cookbook. A part of him hoped the bartender had poured a pint of rat poison by mistake. "I don't get it, Chum," he murmured gloomily. "At school they said I had talent, a real knack for acting. Was it all a lie or what?" "Dude, there are billions of people on this rock," Scop shrugged. "Can't work out for everyone." Kibble flicked on his olfactory booster and gave his beverage a whiff. Smelled just like the wet mop in the bathroom. Maybe worse. Then, not knowing why, he suddenly recalled the merc he talked to a week ago in a popular punk dive he liked to frequent. Well, okay, maybe talked is generous, but grievances were certainly aired. The merc swept the floor with him that night and threatened to put a bullet between his tonsils if he ever spilled her tequila again. This is it, he thought. Rot gut and tequila. Unemployed losers and hot shot mercs. The latter with the world at their feet. It's people like Kibble who are just a theater set piece, who make up the backdrop against which the Sandovistan boosted mercs of the world can shine bright as stars. Kibble decided then and there that he didn't want to just be a splotch in the background anymore. "Why? Why doesn't it ever shake out for us?" he asked with sour grimace. "Why did this city only reward bloodthirsty, bullet-crazy punks, while the rest of us normal saps, without murderous tendencies, have to huddle over our cheap glasses of green cockroach piss?" Scop shrugged again. "I don't know. Find a gun. Find a gun. Buy an edgy jacket, he suggested indifferently, with a note of sarcasm. Shoot up some gang haunts. Have the punkiest time of your life for 4.5 seconds. What the hell just happened here? Kibble continued his rant. The world's all upside down. There are billions just like you and me. Billions of do-nothings, cowards. No, not cowards. People who just want things to be normal. Safety. Life. Life, Scott. Scott had already opened his mouth, ready to list off another round of cynical retorts, but then stopped himself short and started a tangent of his own. Life, he repeated slowly and ponderously. What if I could sell the world? An alternate life. The same all those edge runners feel, except where you won't ever die like they do. Kibble snorted and spat out the cockroach piss he finally mustered the courage to taste. Sorry to burst your bubble, Chum, but someone's way ahead of you there. Ever heard of Bloody Bout 4? Or like a million other computer games? Scop cracked a roguish smile. Is Bloody Bout 4 one of those, or those million other games designed to work on a hybrid brain dance system? You know, the kind I made a breakthrough on just last week? I think you're onto something there. Nomad Cookbook from 2034, last one. Aunt Mary Lou's Juicy Opossum Roast. Opossum. The fatter the better. Oof. 3 parsnips, 1 celery stalk, sin bacon, olive pomace oil. Fry opossum and bacon together in oil until crisp, skimming any excess fat. Once browned, remove and set aside meat. Remove outer strings of celery, chop into small pieces, and boil in a separate pot. When soft, remove and blend with grated parsnip in pan with remaining oil until you have celery parsnip mousse. Add meat to a roasting dish, then cover with mousse and bake at medium-high heat for 20 minutes. Remember that opossum pairs best with white turnip salad. Now you're prepared for the next big family dinner with this holiday crowd pleaser. Say it ain't snake soup. Snake meat, 2 types, water snake and rattlesnake. Chicken scraps, pork bones, fish head, optional, various other scraps. Lemon leaves, seasonal or synthetic veggies, cornstarch, fresh ginger sliced, dark soy sauce, various spices to taste. The most important thing to remember about snake soup is that it shouldn't taste like snake. Step 1. Chop everything that needs chopping. Step 2. Chuck everything in a pot and boil for at least 6 hours. Step 3. Add more of anything as needed for taste. Step 4. Stir in cornstarch to thicken. Okay. I'm actually done with all our stuff. So we're going to be heading to this other stuff. This and this next time. We have a few other things to do. As I said before, I'm going to be finishing off the wasteland stuff before I head back to the city. So thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.